So this morning's breakfast kickoff speaker is Cindy Cohn, who is just assumed this year the executive director post of the Electronic Frontier Foundation. For the prior 14 years, she was the legal director of the Electronic Frontier Foundation, or EFF for short. And for those that aren't familiar with the EFF, it is an international nonprofit that is at the forefront of nearly every major digital rights issue and privacy issue that's being fought today. It's considered one of the most reputable and fiercely independent groups working for technology users' rights. It's a membership dues association and has over 24,000 members currently. As I mentioned, Ms. Cohn has been involved with EFF for over 20 years and has acted as legal director from 2000 to 2015. During her tenure, Ms. Cohn led the charge on EFF cases that tried to rein in the National Security Agency well before the NSA's digital surveillance revelations were made by Edward Snowden several years ago. On this issue, Cohn serves as counsel in Jewell versus NSA and First Unitarian Church versus NSA, each seeking to stop the digital dragnet warrantless surveillance of ordinary Americans. Ms. Cohn has also served as coordinating counsel for over 40 national class action lawsuits against telecommunication companies for sharing customer data with the government. And I mentioned that this all occurred well before the Edward Snowden revelations. EFF actually filed the first case, Hepping versus AT&T, in 2006 for violating its customers' rights in sharing customer data. Other issues that Ms. Cohn has spearheaded while with the EFF was the California Reader Privacy Act. This was co-sponsored by the EFF and required law enforcement to obtain a court order to access reading records held by online booksellers that do business in California. And this was a federal law passed in 2011. Passed in the state. She coordinated the national litigation strategy regarding the security and accountability of electronic voting machines throughout the country. She also argued in the Northern District case, OPG versus Diebold, where an e-voting manufacturer, Diebold, was held liable for basically sending out unfounded cease and desist letters for internet service providers who were posting internal emails of Diebold that essentially showed the flaws of their e-voting system. Other issues at the EFF that Ms. Cohn is currently monitoring and advocating as executive director is continuing the fight against the NSA and making sure that they are within the rule of law. Reining in local law enforcement that unfortunately have adopted many of the NSA's strategies on internet surveillance without a warrant. Advocating for patent reform to curb corporate abuses of patent use that instead of using it to protect their intellectual property, they use it to essentially create barriers to entry to innovators. Previous to her work at the EFF, Ms. Cohn is a graduate of the University of Michigan Law School. She worked for a year at the UN Center for Human Rights in Geneva, Switzerland. She worked in private practice for 10 years, working on a variety of technology and human rights related cases, and was counseled in federal court arising from Chevron's abuses against environmental protesters in Nigeria. In 2007, the National Law Journal named Ms. Cohn one of the 50 most influential women lawyers in the country. In 2010, the State Bar awarded Ms. Cohn its Intellectual Property Vanguard Award. In 2013, the National Law Journal named Ms. Cohn one of the 100 most influential lawyers in America. And they noted, if Big Brother is watching, he better look out for Cindy Cohn. She was featured recently in the San Jose Mercury News, and they listed a number of factoids that were, fun. And the one that really resonated with me, and that I think that really speaks to the fight that she would lead throughout her career, is that Ms. Cohn was a high school cheerleader, but she was kicked off her squad for insubordination.
When Teresa called me and asked me if I'd come to speak out here, I despite having to get up really early in the morning to make it here from San Francisco, I immediately said yes. And I said yes because my very first trial as a young puppy lawyer practicing in a small firm in San Mateo was here in Contra Costa County Municipal Court. And I won, so I have fond feelings about that. And it also was one of those awesome early moments as a young lawyer, because I got into the courtroom, they called the case, and I realized that I had left all of my trial notes in the trunk of my car. And was forced to kind of wing it. Luckily, as a young, highly over-prepared lawyer, I was able to recite my opening from scratch and take the first break in the case to run out to my car, grab the trial notes, come back, and we were successful. So Contra Costa County has a very warm spot in my heart, and so I will always come here and talk to you guys. Now I'm here today in a slightly different place. I have now been a lawyer for quite a long time, and I do have my notes with me. To talk to you about the Fourth Amendment, and specifically the part of the Fourth Amendment that I'm currently engaged in trying to vindicate in a series of cases against the National Security Agency, arising from a very particular technology that's been put onto the internet by the NSA right here in the Bay Area and all across the country. So I want to explain a little bit about the history of it, explain to you why I think it raises serious constitutional problems, and then I'm happy to take your questions about stingrays and other kinds of things that we're doing, but I'm kind of enmeshed in this right now. PFF, as the introductor introduced, we began trying to raise concerns about the NSA's mass spying of millions of ordinary Americans in early 2006. And we did this because we had a whistleblower walk into our offices in San Francisco and hand us documents from AT&T's facility in Folsom Street in San Francisco. So you're going down 3rd Street in San Francisco, you're on your way to the Bay Bridge. On your right, there's this big dark building that's an AT&T building that doesn't have very many windows in it. And this is the Folsom Street facility, and it's a key facility for AT&T. It's what's called a peering station. So whenever I give a talk to technologists, I always try to teach them a little bit of law, and lawyers, I always try to teach them a little bit of tech. It won't hurt. But I need to explain to you a little bit about how the internet works. And you can be really awesome if you go and you see your tech friends, you can like play this in front of them, I think you're really cool. A peering station is the part of the internet where your communications on your local network, AT&T, get handed off to the broader internet, and then end up, say, if you're emailing somebody who's a Verizon person or you're going to a website that's hosted by Amazon, the peering station is where your communications go from your provider to the broader internet and then ultimately to their places. And what the whistleblower, Mark Klein, who lives in Alameda, brought us was evidence that the NSA was tapping into the fiber optic cables that are in these peering stations and making a copy of everything that transits through those stations. And here's a description, here's a little picture of it that we had our staff technologists put together, our staff artists at EFF put together. So you can see, and I think this is important to understanding how the Constitution plays here, so bear with me. You can see on the left millions of AT&T customers. You can see the switching station starting at number one. There's a technology there called a fiber optic splitter. A fiber optic splitter is a really simple piece of technology. You guys may know your communications are carried on the fiber optic cables by a beam of light, right? Carried on beam presses and commercials is a cool beam of light kind of thing. A fiber optic splitter splits the beam of light into two. And the cool thing about light is that when you split light into two, you don't get halfsies. You get a full copy of all the data that's being carried on the light. So you can see one copy of your communication goes directly across from that splitter and goes to their intended recipients on the right-hand side. The other copy goes into the NSA control. And it goes through a series of filters. It goes through a search. And then it ends up in a government database. This is the infrastructure that's been installed in Folsom Street and at least 8 or 10 other places across the country that are key carrying stations for AT&T. It appears that similar installations occurred at key Verizon stations places across the country. So you can see here, we're foreshadowing a little bit what I'm going to talk about. I want to talk about step one, which we call an unconstitutional seizure, and step three, which we call an unconstitutional search, and I'll explain to you why I think that's true. So we're going to talk today about the Internet Backbone Collection. That's what this infrastructure is. We're not going to talk about a lot of other things that the NSA is doing. I'm happy to answer questions, but there's just too much to go deep enough into it. One of them is the PRISM program, which you may have heard of. That's when the NSA has set up systems that we don't quite understand yet, but to go to not the infrastructure carriers like AT&T, but people like Google and Facebook and others, and get information about their customers directly from them. That program is called PRISM. I'll talk a little bit about the telephone records collection, a program that's ending in about a week or so at the end. That's a collection of your who you call, how often you call them, that has been handed to the government for about 15 years. Not going to talk about the Internet metadata collection, also a program that was allegedly stopped in 2006, but if you read today's New York Times, it indicates that the government continued to do the same collection, they just did it under a different legal authority. We'll be looking closely at that. I'm not going to talk about foreign mass collection, which is also something that's going on, and I think especially relevant in light of the intelligence failures that led to the Paris attacks not being caught. Sharing with foreign governments, hacking malware, all sorts of other good things that they're doing. I'm not going to talk about today in any depth. Here's one of those slides that Mr. Snowden brought forward that the government has not denied that shows kind of where this technology that I talked about that we discovered in 2006 fits into the government's plan. And so you can see PRISM on the bottom, I talked about that a little bit. And then the program I'm talking about is the upstream program. And you can see here that the NSA is carefully telling its people, you should do both. So what's the fundamental problem with these kinds of infrastructures? To me, the fundamental problem is it turns the basic deal that we have with our government upside down. The basic idea, I think, embedded in the Fourth Amendment, and I also think embedded in the First Amendment of the Constitution, is that the government isn't watching what you're doing unless they've got good reason, unless they can make a showing to a judge. If not full probable cause showing, like we have in Title III, at least some showing that is targeting you, and that otherwise you get to have a zone of freedom where you can operate without the government watching what you're doing and potentially using what it finds. What this does is it flips everything upside down because the government is collecting everything first and it's analyzing it and then sorting out second, once it has custody of this information, what it actually needs. The government calls this process where they winnow down and analyze what they're doing, minimization. And those of you who are criminal defense attorneys may be familiar with that term. It's also what you use when, say, you've got a wiretap on Tony Soprano and you accidentally, you know, catch a call that Carmela Soprano is making. They rely on minimization to weed out from the targets. Well, the government has taken this idea of minimization and put it on steroids and thought, well, if you could do that, if you can, you know, if you can capture Carmela Soprano and then just narrow it down to Tony later, why don't we just capture the entire country's communications and then we'll narrow it down later to what we want? And that's, I think, the fundamental philosophy undermining what's going on with the NSA and to a sad extent, the FBI right now. I think there's a salient quote in the Riley versus California Supreme Court case that came out just 2 years ago where the government made a similar argument. They said, well, don't worry, we want to search everything that's on somebody's cell phone if we stop them incident to arrest, but we'll have processes in place to make sure that we only get the stuff that we really need. And Justice Roberts kind of, I think, somewhat eloquently dismissed that argument from law enforcement with the quote that you see here. So you don't have to believe me that their collection collected all is their process. I stole that word from there. This is a slide from the Snowden slides. that were used internally in the government to explain to themselves what it is they were doing. This is their, what they call their new collection posture, which is, as you can see, collected all. There's only one of the it-alls that they have here. This is a slide that's aimed at their foreign collection. But they have a similar ideology for their domestic collection as well, and I've been on panels with NSA people who have actually agreed with me that that's true. So I'm not making this up. So let's go back to the law a little bit. The part that should be a little easier. Why do we have a Fourth Amendment to the Constitution, or how does the Fourth Amendment work? The Fourth Amendment asks a series of questions. The first question is it a search or a seizure? It's not a search or a seizure, then the Fourth Amendment doesn't apply. The question about whether it's a search or a seizure is the issue that where the Fourth Amendment analysis in the telephone records cases and the metadata cases come up. The government argues that merely collecting the data about your calls as opposed to the content of your calls isn't a search or a seizure, so the Fourth Amendment doesn't apply. I'll talk a little bit more about that later, but I wanted to just flag that. That's where that conversation starts. But if it's a search, then a warrant is needed. The 702 of the FISA Amendments Act is the authority the government is doing this upstream collection under currently. And there are FISC orders. The FISC is the secret court, the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court, that allow this kind of collection. However, they're not warrants. They're programmatic. The government just explains kind of roughly what it's about to do, and the FISC says those procedures sound good. So 702, nobody's arguing. 702 FISC orders are not warrants, they're programmatic approvals. They certainly don't meet Fourth Amendment standard, and they don't even meet the federal wiretap standard. The other exception to the Fourth Amendment that often comes in here is the government has what's called a special needs exception. This is the exception that applies to searching high school kids for drugs if they want to play on the basketball team, for other kinds of short stops that are very usually aimed at a very specific population for a very specific purpose. The government argues that special needs applies to everything they do in the name of terrorism, and I'll talk a little bit about why I think that shouldn't be a successful argument. The Fourth Amendment also has a very specific history. If you go to the famous cemetery in Boston of all the patriots that founded our country, you'll find honored in them a guy named James Otis. And James Otis was a lawyer in colonial America who was objecting to something called general warrants and writs of assistance. This was a kind of warrant-like thing that the colonial troops would get where they would go to a court and they would say, somebody's engaging in tax evasion, see Boston Tea Party, or someone is engaging in fomenting a revolution, see the founding of our country. And this general warrant, without specifically identifying the persons or the places to be searched, could be then used by the colonial troops to go in and search anybody's houses who they wanted to, without the kind of specificity that we now know is common in our warrants. And it was this challenge, James Otis brought a challenge against these general warrants in the British courts, and he lost. This is a quote from John Adams, who attended part of the trial in England, and you can see from his quote, he cites this failure to stop the colonial troops from having general warrants as the reason why we started our country. So it's no surprise that the Fourth Amendment has language in it about being secure in our papers, in our homes, as part of what we get in liberty in the United States. So this is a slide that was recently released by the New York Times. It's a little complicated, but you can see where the government, I believe it's the little diamonds. I may be wrong about that. The little triangles are the places, and then the pyramid routers, the little blue squares, if you can see them, are the ones that are the pairing rings. The little diamonds are where they have slithers. So this is a program that is domestic. This isn't all on the border. It's not where the cables come up from international. It's not where the satellites come down. It's all over the country. I think it's hard to look at this map and say that this is just an international-focused program. It's not where you pull these things. Just a little bit of pride. In 2006, we took the information that our client gave us, and we asked our expert, a guy named J. Scott Marcus, to draw us a picture of what this thing might look like. This is the picture that he drew in 2006. This is a picture of what it looks like that was released by the New York Times out of the NSA just recently. You put them side by side, you can see that J. Scott Marcus is an awesome expert. I think I've got a lot of trial, hopefully got some trial attorneys here. The idea that you're expert 9 years before you actually get the facts does a pretty dead-on drawing of how complicated technology works is something that doesn't happen to me much in my career. So we're pretty proud about that, and Marcus is an awesome expert. And again, you can see the steps that we go through, but then we turned into the cartoon that I started, but it's the same thing. So, you're pretty right about how this worked. So, as I mentioned, the government claims that it has the authority to do this mass surveillance under something called the FISA Amendments Act, Section 702. Section 702 was passed in 2008, which you might notice 2 years after I started suing the NSA for this. That's because prior to this, the NSA engaged in this activity under claims of pure presidential authority, that the executive branch had pure authority without to do this without any need for congressional or other vice court approval. This is a legal theory put forward by John Yoo, who teaches just down the hall here in Berkeley, that was later judged to be grossly insufficient by later lawyers who came in, not the least of which because it ignored the fact that we had a FISA law that said that the exclusive means by which you can spy on Americans is under FISA and not under executive authority. So this, what I think is probably fairly something that would get you thrown, would be called legal malpractice had it happened in the commercial world, was the basis upon which we were all spied on for about 7 years. But then in 2008, they passed the FISA Amendments Act. It allows the government to do spying if they're targeting a non-US person overseas, or if they are collecting foreign-to-foreign communications that have to transit through the United States. And with this, we launched our second case called Jewel versus NSA. Interestingly, Section 702 doesn't mention mass surveillance. It doesn't say anything about incidental collection. It doesn't say anything about sitting on the fiber optic cables of the United States. It says the government is authorized to target foreigners with domestic collection. So I think the government is arguing about a whole lot of elephants hiding in mouse holes to try to argue that this statute authorizes mass collection, but this is something I'm hoping to bring up in front of the courts. Again, I just put some information here about the scope of this. The incidental collection is actually probably close to 90% of what they're collecting here, 90 to 95% with a very tiny amount being the targeted collection. And I think that even if you think it's okay for the government to do this, you've got to wonder whether minimization can be stretched this far. I certainly do. 702, as I mentioned, is not a warrant. Again, I will let you just read. I don't think it's very useful to read out loud slides, but I think it's pretty straightforward, and I don't think the government actually disagrees with me about that point. 702 is not the same as the traditional FISA law, the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act, which requires a lot more targeting. Most importantly, the FISA law doesn't allow you to target somebody just because they happen to be a foreigner abroad. It requires somebody to be an agent of a foreign power. We're talking about spies here. So it's a pretty big distinction, and I think one that is raised not just the eyebrows, but the hackles of people all around the world, that the NSA maintains that everybody who's not an American and goes overseas is fair game for their surveillance, as opposed to the traditional FISA requirement. And the traditional FISA, lots of people don't like the secret FISA court, but the secret FISA court actually has rules that require evidence to be shown that somebody is an agent of a foreign power before they authorize surveillance. So while I'm not a big fan of the secret FISA court now, it's important to remember the Section 702 and the kind of mass surveillance they're doing now really limited the limited the view of the FISA court in doing this. So back to our little drawing. Now I want to walk you through a little more specifically about seizure and search. So let's start with stage one, the generalized seizure, and segue back a little into law. The Fourth Amendment says that something's a seizure if you lose your right to dominion and control over it. There's a couple cases that I sent there that we're relying on. This is pretty straightforward. Our argument is by making a copy of your communications without your approval or knowledge for purposes other than delivering your email, the government is seizing that information, and the Fourth Amendment should apply. That's how we get the case seizure. The government's argument against seizure is they claim that the right against search and seizure only has to do with the timely delivery of your packages, which I think would come as quite a surprise to the colonial powers. Relying on some of the contraband cases where people at FedEx, for instance, were calling in the government, and the government was coming and seizing stuff in FedEx, and there's some language in some of the cases about how you have a right to the timely delivery of your packages and that the government can't interfere. The government's trying to say that that's the only thing that the Fourth Amendment protects you against with seizure, and I would argue that it's a little bigger than that. The other thing the government argues is because they can search through the content of your communications really quickly, thanks to computers, that, you know, there's no harm, no foul. I mean, you shouldn't worry about it because it's not getting in the way of the communications and things, because they can do it really, really quickly and it doesn't delay delivery of your communications. I think the fact that, you know, if the colonial soldiers could come into the houses of the colonists and search it really, really quickly, that wouldn't have changed the reason that James Otis sued or the reason we have the Fourth Amendment now, but I think that's the government's argument if you apply it backwards. And of course, there's no suspicion here, which is different than all the contraband cases and the other cases that they're relying on to do this. So that's the government's argument. I should be clear here, I am an advocate, so I suspect if my my opposing counsel here from the Department of Justice was giving his side of this, it might be a little less dismissive of their arguments than I am, but you just have to write them here to get that heard. The nice benefit of being me is that I'm an advocate. I don't have to pretend like that I'm even-handed in this. So. Then the other thing that the government does is, back to our picture, there was a stage two where they do some rudimentary filtering to try to take out information that doesn't have one in foreign, the fully domestic stuff. There's a lot of arguments about whether that could be sufficient or not, how hard it is to find, separate out fully domestic communications from one end, international ones, but I'll leave those to side for the moment. Then, for what they keep after they've done that initial cut on the data, they do a full text search. Full text search, content searching of this. So for those of you who are interested in this, you know, distinction between, you know, content and non-content, which kind of undermines a lot of our current jurisprudence around Title III, stage three is a content search. And the government admits it, they call it about searching. So they're searching for not just communications to or from their targets, but about their targets. So if your communications have, you know, you're talking about Osama bin Laden, if Osama bin Laden's email address is one of the ones in their targets, then they will search, your communication will be kept in that search and not tossed aside. So that's their communications. I think there are reasonable expectation of privacy in that, and the Fourth Amendment requires more than just a programmatic warrant from the FISA court in order for them to be able to do that search. The government says you shouldn't worry because there are humans searching your communications. It's just computers, so you should rest easy. We should, as long as there's no human eyes doing the search, it shouldn't count. They say this is like a dog sniff or a chemical test, both of which are very targeted at what they can receive, whereas a full text search can look at the entire content of the communications. And of course, the chemical tests and the dog sniffs are looking for illegal material. They're looking for drugs. And the content of your speech is not illegal behavior. Indeed, it has constitutional protection, so I don't think those cases apply either. There's a nice case about hash functions. I'm happy to talk about that. Someone else asked, but I think I've done enough tech for you guys for the moment. And then the government's argument is even if a warrant is required, this is a search and seizure exception under special needs. This is the special needs test. And I think if we have a serious, we're able to have a serious discussion about this, this is what's going to be the fundamental thing that the court's going to have to wrestle with is the spawning of the entire country as a national security concern sufficient to, is a special need. It would be by far the biggest special need that the court has ever authorized, far different than just spot checks at a checkpoint in an area where people are known to have drunk driving or a student who wants to play basketball on a team. So this would be a sea change. It is, we believe, why the secret price support has authorized this in 702 is constitutional, although the government has refused to release those rulings. We know there are some rulings. We don't know what they say, but our best guess is this is what they convinced the price of court could authorize this, because there's clearly no warrant going on here. So where are we in our cases? Well, Jewell versus NSA is our centerpiece case looking at this. We moved for a summary judgment in last year. In February, Judge White, Federal District Court of Northern District of California, dismissed our case on the grounds of secrecy. He said, basically, that even though I can show you all these things, we can have this conversation here, I will have it if anybody has, the governance program is still too secret and for the court to be able to decide whether the Constitution applies or not. And we are appealing that decision. And the Ninth Circuit, the government has argued that the Ninth Circuit can't consider that until they consider every other case claim in our case. We tried to narrow down this Fourth Amendment case and bring it up. And that was argued in the Ninth Circuit in Pasadena about 2 weeks ago. The government's foot dragging here is somewhat epic. Epic even by the scale of the government's foot dragging that we've experienced before. So they're trying to tell the Ninth Circuit that it can't decide this yet. I think it will be unfortunate if the courts decide to absent themselves from this under claims of secrecy, given how much the American people already know. Everything I've shown you here is public, and a significant percentage of what I've shown you here, the government has actually admitted. And tiny little bits like the actual slides, they haven't authenticated, but the big story here has been admitted, and the government defends it in conversations that I have with them in public all the time. And so I think it would be a tremendous shame for our court system to decide that they had to blind themselves to this. But that's where we are with the case. And now we've got a couple. So that's the upstream. I hope I've convinced you that I'm right, or at least that this is a case worth watching, because I think it's fascinating and interesting, and it has a lot of implications for how we're going to live as a society. I think because the telephone records case is about, the telephone records collection is about to be ended, unless the members of Congress get their way and they get it extended, it's going to end on November 29th, just in time for my birthday on November 30th. Thank you, federal government. And the question about telephone records case involves, as I said, this question about metadata, the question about whether the Fourth Amendment applies at all to the communications metadata that you create every day. Who you talk to, how often you talk to them, often where you are when you talk to them, because your phones also keep the location, although the telephone records that are collecting do not have location data in them. The government's argument is that metadata doesn't have Fourth Amendment protections, and they're relying on a case from 1979 called Smith versus Maryland. And another case, a banking case as well, California. But the Smith case is the central case that they rely on, and I'm just pointing out here that I think that this is a pretty thin read for the government to argue that all metadata in every single instance can never have Fourth Amendment protection. I think the Fourth Amendment was designed to give us a zone of privacy where we can speak freely, where we can have communications. I also think the First Amendment right of association is implicated here. I'm going to include a slide because we have short time today. But the ability to communicate with people privately in order to organize politically or culturally has long been protected by the First Amendment under some case law that stretches back to the 1950s, a series of cases involving the NAACP, NAACP versus Alabama, and versus Button, and some of these other cases that you may remember from law school, protected people's rights to associate privately. The question in that case was that the state of Alabama was demanding that the NAACP turn over its membership list as a condition for opening an office in the state of Alabama. And the Supreme Court said, nobody will join the NAACP if they're going to be handed over to the government when they do, and you have to have a zone of associational privacy in order to have a functioning democracy. I would argue that collecting all the telephone records of the NAACP or the First Unitarian Church of Los Angeles or whatever organization, I have 24 organizations in my First Unitarian Church case, is effectively the same thing as requiring people to turn over their membership lists and their associational records, and should have First Amendment protection regardless of what you think about the Fourth Amendment. And why I think that is because I think the Constitution, while it was written in some ways about individuals, isn't fundamentally about protecting individuals. It's actually about protecting the necessary conditions for a functioning democracy. And the truth is in our country that every social movement, every political movement, every legal movement starts with a private conversation. Somebody had to turn to somebody else and say, you know, I'm not sure slavery is the right way for us to go as a country. And that conversation had to be secret. In my lifetime, conversations about whether gay and lesbian people could marry or whether they had to have equal rights were conversations that had to happen in secrecy. Now we all know we're in this amazing period where we're recognizing those rights. But without the zone of privacy, those communications cannot happen. People can't build associations. People can't build movements. And people can't build democratic action to try to change the course of the country. That's actually why I think both the Fourth Amendment and the First Amendment have such strong privacy implications in them. And it's why I think today we haven't grown as a country to the place where we don't need those protections anymore. So that's why I care about this kind of stuff. Yeah, the text cool too and fun. That's what I think we're asking ourselves as a country, whether we still want to create a zone for people to have a private conversation anymore, or whether we want everything to be not secure in our papers, but insecure in our papers on the off chance that the government decides it's worth listening to. So I think I did okay. There's time for some conversations. By the way, this is our friends at Greenpeace lent us one of their blimps, and we flew it over the Utah data center as a fun little stunt, because you know surveillance can get you down. You gotta have a little fun. So this was one of the things that we did last year to try to draw attention to the place where the government is storing a lot of the massive information that it is collecting. It was great fun. And you know, those Greenpeace guys have really fun tools. I wanted to borrow, they have an undersea thing, and I wanted to do one where we went to where the undersea cables are and put a little arrow there and say what's happening here too. So far we didn't make that happen. So thank you very much for listening to me and letting me present my cases to you. I'm happy to answer any questions about this or about other issues that EFF is working on that might be of use to you. My request to you is that if you have issues that involve electronic surveillance, especially, or deep tech, sometimes we get involved in civil cases as well, please reach out. We have a lot of knowledge. We have a lot of resources available. We have participated in criminal defense briefings just, you know, on the electronic surveillance issues. We filed amicus briefs. We participated in efforts in the California legislature to pass California ECPA that just started. It requires a warrant when the California come looking for your stored data. So we have a lot of resources that are approval, and I think that lawyers operating on the ground in local jurisdictions often see things before we do. And so if you have issues like this, please reach out to us. We also do have a cooperating attorneys list where we can help connect you to people who have digital rights problems. If these are issues that are really compelling to you, we can't take every case that comes our way, but we refer a lot of work out, and we also help connect lawyers to co-counsel that they might need who have technical specialties. So, you know, we view ourselves as part of the legal community in the Bay Area, and we're happy to end nationally as well. But as I said, I have special fondness for this county, and we'd like to be able to be helpful to you in your cases as well. So I'm happy to answer any questions. Thank you. Yeah?
How do you deal with the questions raised recently because a lot of the terrorist attacks where it's been insisted that we have to have the status to catch the bad guys? So how do you address that?
Well, the main thing, the question is, how do we deal with things like, you know, arguments that because of the terrorist attacks, we to limit people's ability to have privacy and secrecy. I was just on KQED's forum yesterday, got to debate an FBI guy about this. And so it depends on what they want to do. There's kind of different answers. The big thing that they're talking about now is we need to stop people's ability to use strong encryption, secret codes to protect their communications in rest or transiting. And, you know, the big argument about that, I think there's two big arguments about that. One is that, well, first of all, there's no evidence that the Paris bombers use encryption at all. In fact, they all lived in the same neighborhood in Belgium. It appears that the meeting face-to-face was how most of this thing was planned. So far, you know, the one phone that they found wasn't encrypted at all. So jumping to encryption before the smoke's cleared and the bodies are buried is a policy thing. I think I got a little cranky a couple days ago and wrote about how cynical I thought that was. But more importantly, encryption is what we need to protect ourselves against bad guys. So, you know, the FBI is basically arguing that because some people might be bad guys, we should all not put locks on our doors. So it would be really easy for them to come into your house and search it if they need to, and they wouldn't have to worry about, you know, breaking locks or anything. And I think if that was what the proposal was said in the real world, we would all say, no, actually, that's not at all. Like, that's not going to keep us safer. It's going to make us less safe. And it's not really going to help you that much when the time comes that you've got a target anyway. But when they call it encryption and it's about the internet and the digital things, like suddenly what is actually, I think, a pretty ill-formed idea gets traction. But it's the same thing. They're arguing that we should all be less secure in order to make sure that they will be absolutely assured that they can read every single communication that they want to read. I think that's the wrong path to go on. We have a cybersecurity crisis right now because things are so poorly secure. You know, the OPM, the fingerprints and classified information was massively released from the Office of Personnel Management federally because the federal government can't secure it very well. I think the answer is to harden our security to keep us safe, not weaken it. Other kinds of things that they might want to do, that, you know, France passed one of the broadest surveillance authorities in the world after the Charlie Hebdo attacks. And before that, they had very few limits on surveillance. So France has been a surveillance mecca for a very, very long time. And of course, the NSA has dragged that surveillance over France, over Belgium, over Syria, and massive powers under Executive Order 12333 and Section 702 that I walked you through, that if you're a foreigner abroad, it's open season, they can spy on you. They didn't catch this attack. So I would argue that maybe rather than trying to collect more data, we work really hard to make sure that the NSA then mobilizes the information that they have. And this is a sad echo of September 11th, right? The September 11th Commission, the 9/11 Commission, said that the FBI had all of the people who were the bombers in their sights, and they had the ability to track them all. They were not able to operationally pull that data together. Horrible stories, like the guy in Minnesota who had this information didn't know how to get a FISA order, and so just didn't. That even there's really bad stories here about the intelligence failures inside the NSA prior to 9/11. These are all in the 9/11 Commission report. This isn't classified or anything. And then they didn't need more data. They needed to marshal their data better. So what happens after Paris? Well, we hear those same people coming back and saying, oh, the answer here is that we need more data. And I don't think we should offer it again. It's a lot of money. It's building this massive surveillance state is a lot of money. And if we use that money on gumshoe intelligence and targeted acts against people, which are legal, already legal, I think we do a better job. And I think the fact that they came out to try to stop strong encryption before they even figured out what caused this shows that there's a pre-existing agenda going on here and not one that's careful and thoughtful about keeping us safe. And to me, that's just sad. Like, this is important. There are people dying around the world, and for this to be used to build your pet project so you can still get another big government contract to continue to surveil everybody is the worst kind of cynicism, in my opinion.
But if you do that, when you target it, then you'll be accused of profiling.
No, targeting has to do with evidence about the particular person and their activities. Profiling is about trying to target people based upon things like their religion or their things. I mean, the difference between targeting and profiling is pretty easy to see. if they've got individual evidence about a particular thing you've done. And it's profiling has gotten, you know, the French said, well, the problem we have is that we've got over 7,000 people that we're trying to keep track of all the time. And that's because they engage in profiling rather than targeting. So I think that this rush to try to just assume somebody's a terrorist based upon their religious belief or the country of origin that they come from is part of how they're drowning in data, as opposed to doing the real work necessary to figure out what's going on in these areas to give people, you know, most of the people who are so far the terrorists that have been revealed so far are particularly religious, right? But they were from poor suburbs and have some historical ties to some of these parts of the country. But it doesn't look like the guy who was the mastermind ever went to a mosque. He was a secular person. So profiling is about trying to take somebody's religion and make assumptions about whether they're likely to be terrorists. That's very different than talking.
Do you have any idea what it's costing to employ all these people at NASA? I mean, I'm afraid that we're spending so much money that we could divert to useful things, like educating our population a little better.
I agree. You know, we don't know how much money is being spent on this. There's some bits and pieces, and I've been trying to do this. The Washington Post did a piece about 3 years ago where they tried to tally up how much the surveillance state cost, but it was before the Snowden revelation. So I think we know a lot more, and I've been trying to convince some reporters to dig through all these slides and add up the money to try to figure it out, but it's a lot. This is not small. And, you know, I think there's a piece of this that, you know, a lot of the companies that are selling this technology to the government are Silicon Valley companies or Southern California defense industry contractors. So I think turning a little inward, you know, one of the talks I give when I talk to techs is, you know, if you don't want to live in a surveillance state, maybe you should stop selling it to our government. We know it's a lot of money. We don't know how much. It's a part of this, the black budget. It gets a little complicated to try to figure it out. And that's why I'm hoping to unleash some investigative reporters to try to give us some real, some reliable numbers. Yes?
I went to law school in England in the 60s, and what I remember about constitutional law is that it was an unwritten constitution and the rest could stick in your eye. So do you know whether the UK has a similar kind of program?
Yes, GCHQ, which is the British version of the NSA, and I forget what it's called, headquarters is where HQ is, but I remember the other thing. They have a very similar program. They work very closely together. In fact, there's a lot of evidence that you know, the Americans are theoretically not supposed to spy on Americans domestically, so the British do it and handle the information and vice versa. And we know about at least one incident involving the law firm named Brennan & Platt in Chicago, where the Australian authorities intercepted their communications with their clients who were in Indonesia and handed it over to the U.S. government to assist them in trade talks. So the idea that this is all just used for terrorists has been kind of debunked by the stories that have come out as well. And the idea that your petty little attorney-client privilege is going to survive in the NSA, that comes at that side too. So yes, and in fact, the British are now debating something that they call the Snooper's Charter to try to bring more of what GCHQ does up into law. This made it a secret, kind of like what happened with 702. And there's a furious fight going on in England right these days now. David Cameron is hell-bent on doing this, and you know, my counterparts in England are trying to stop it and try to bring more light on things. So British, sadly, are really partners, strong partners with the NSA in all of these strategies. There's something called the Five Eyes, so it's the UK, the US, Australia, Canada, and
Germany.
Hmm?
Germany?
No, it's all the English-speaking countries. So anyway, it'll come to me in a second. Freely share intelligence back and forth, and then there's circles out from different countries. Germany is one that's a little further out in the cycle. So it's a global problem. I mean, it's a lot of people around the world. You know, we do a lot of work internationally. They really want to blame the NSA for this and, you know, demonize the Americans. And I think it's fair to say that the Americans have the biggest program and the most effective program, but, you know, this is a global problem. And there are international human rights, you know, the international human rights counterpart is to the U.S. Constitution requires that all surveillance be necessary and proportionate, and U.N. Special Rapporteur on Privacy that was just introduced said that mass surveillance is not even necessary for proportionate under international law. So there's work going on all around the world around this kind of
with email becoming such a big part of our law practice, I hate to ask, but where do we stand for confidentiality and certified privilege for email communication to our clients?
Well, as a legal matter, you don't need to encrypt your communications under the ethical rules. There were some efforts for a while ago to try to require that in order to say that you were doing sufficient confidentiality. I think if you've got something that you don't want, especially if you're in a criminal, the context in which you don't want the government to have access to the information, or a very sophisticated party on the other side, using encryption is a good idea. Actually, probably your client's audit and system on it. Because we've seen a lot of hacking, and we've seen a lot of hacking in civil cases as well. There was recently one where one football team was hacking into another football team's servers and stuff. So if you've got intellectual property or confidential information, attorney-client stuff that's really sensitive, I think it makes sense to use encryption. That's the bad news. The good news is that encryption programs like PGP or GPG are getting easier to use. Things like instant messaging programs like Signal or Telegraph are even easier to use. So it's not email, it's instant messaging, but you'll get better security and they're easier to use. And I see, you know, in my communications with people that are sensitive, I tend to use those kinds of tools. EFF has a manual that we published on our website called Surveillance Self-Defense that is aimed at human rights activists around the world. So it's really aimed at an audience that really does your life and death depend on it. But there's some good, we tried to make it as accessible as we could to non-technical people and have really specific and practical recommendations. So if you want a good kind of overview, there's lots of people writing, this is ours. That's a pretty good place to look. And we tried to put as many good explanations on how to install this stuff and use it as we could. Back in the back.
Do you think that the younger generation has a lower expectation of privacy in electronic communications due to just being able to communicate outside the home and social media, and that kind of undermines this whole conversation?
So this is a question I get all the time. Do we think that kids today, you know, they're not playing pool like they were in the music band or don't care about their privacy. The data is pretty clear. There's a woman named Dana Boyd who works at Microsoft. There's a guy named Chris McNagel who is at the iSchool at UC Berkeley who actually does surveys of kids about how they feel about privacy and tracks children's use of privacy protective measures. Kids care more about their privacy than adults. They do take more steps to try to protect their privacy than most adults do. What we have with a lot of kids is what I would call exhibitionism, right? Kids feel like less of what they do, they're worried about keeping private than they used to. But there is a phenomenon called the senior Facebook, right? Where seniors in high school will create fake Facebook profiles so that they can talk freely about what they're doing and then delete it and have it not follow them through to college. How many adults do you know do that, right? I have friends where parents are like, my daughter's not having a Facebook page and she won't friend me on it. And I'm like, this is not because kids understand that they want a zone of privacy. They want that zone to be a little different than maybe people who lived through the Holocaust want. But they're actually more privacy protective and actually more privacy savvy than adults if you actually look down on it. And I think that that this is something, you know, it's an easy what's a matter with kids today kind of thing. I also think the first generation of people who used Facebook didn't understand how much they were being tracked. And if you look at younger kids, they're more careful than they used to be. And they also don't want to be on Facebook. You know, I mean, kids really don't worry about privacy using the government. But honestly, they don't worry about much using the government. They worry about privacy using their parents and their peers. And another, you know, just their kids still, right? So I think the data doesn't bear out that truism. I think there's a lot of people in Silicon Valley who would like you to not care about your privacy very much, who are trying to indicate to you that you're just an old fogey if you care about your privacy. And so this message just keeps coming out. I also think kids share more than adults share, but you shouldn't confuse, I mean, to me, privacy isn't about how much you decide to share. It's about who decides to share it. It's about control over what you share, not about whether you decide to share one thing or another. Kids today are willing to share more about themselves than adults, but it doesn't mean that they're willing to give up control on quite the opposite.
And did EFF try and do anything to nip the data collection in the bud? it's been going on well over 20 years with omnivore and carnivore. And we knew about it in the 90s with carnivore, because the government admitted they were doing it.
Yeah, well, you know, at this point, EFF is the biggest it's ever been, and there are 70 of us. And the federal government, a little bigger. So, you know, I've been fighting this stuff for a long time. We've been fighting the courts, we've been fighting public opinion. In the early days, in the 90s, it was very, very difficult to convince people, you know, that to even explain this, right? This, you know, you guys all understood, I think, at least I hope a percentage of you understood what I was talking about. If I gave these presentations to you guys in 1995 about how carnivore works, I think there would have been a lot more blank stares, right? We're all more technically proficient. So, you know, we work hard on these issues, but, you know, we're a pretty tiny little organization compared to who we're up against, and even, you know, there's a bigger movement now for digital rights and digital freedom than ever. And we, you know, we stopped the bad law, that copyright law called Soto and Pippa. We've done some stuff in Congress to begin to flex our muscle, but this is the biggest we've ever been. And people like to join in if they want to help them. You know, I can't magically, through a tiny little office on Eddy Street in the Tenderloin, change the nation's direction. I might be able to convince somebody in a black robe that I'm right. Maybe if I'm lucky, I'll convince 9 people in D.C. in black robes. But if we really want to make social change, I mean, I'm here, you know, I said I want to help you with your cases, but I'm here to recruit you, you know, join us in trying to stand up for this, because it's the numbers that matter. You know, Zoe Lofgren is an awesome friend in Congress. Einstein's horrible. How do we get members of Congress who get this stuff and who care about our privacy as opposed to other things, you know, as opposed to being on the wrong side of these things? So it's an ongoing fight. But you're right in that the techniques that I'm describing here weren't developed after 9/11. What happened after 9/11 is a lot of ideas that have been floating around or tried out in smaller kind of ways. Suddenly, the Bush administration just opened the floodgates and let the NSA do all of its dream surveillance techniques. So almost everything that's going on here has analogs and stuff that was happening 5 or 10 years before. That's kind of how the technology had to develop. Are we done? All right, I think that's my last question.